Welcome to SBJ Spotlight. I'm Austin Karp. Joining me is Morgyn Wynne, first baseman for the Oklahoma State softball team, a senior. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
You know, Morgyn, over these last couple days, we've talked to a whole host of college administrators, athletic directors, conference commissioners, just to kind of about like the landscape and what's really kind of keeping them up at night. We want a student athlete's perspective. You know, with regard to name, image, and likeness, what has that meant to you, to other students, in terms of maximizing, you know, revenue opportunities while you are in school?
I think name, image, and likeness is a blessing and a curse. I am thankful for the opportunities that I've had personally, but I think I look at it more holistically for women's sports, comparing that to like the male sports side of things. Like the male athletes, they're just going to get the bigger deals. They're more of the stars, whereas females, it's a little harder, or they have like smaller scale, like more product deals, kind of just like social media aspects. But for me, it's been really fun to educate myself in this space, learn how to brand myself, but also like leverage women's sports with big companies. Like for Oklahoma State, I know our softball program has brand deal with Seth Wedley Ford of Perry in Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And that's not just for the starters or just for the girls with the biggest scholarship checks. Those are for, it's for everybody on the team, like all 26 of us. And so
it's awesome when you see those.
It's great. And I think like when you look at NIL like that, it's great. But then when you start to look at some of the like disparity where it's on the teams where it's just like the top two highest performing, and then
it sounds like it's a boost from morale when you have a team-wide deal because everyone's
right.
Participating. Is that what you've seen?
Yeah, okay. I definitely have seen that. And I think kudos to the people who've been able to really market themselves and use their name and their image to get $25,000 deals, but that's not the case for everybody.
You know, another issue that has come up consistently throughout the sessions here at the conference has been the transfer portal, and just kind of it's very taxing on administrators. But what has that kind of freedom meant that new, for student athletes? You, for example, transferred from Kansas to Oklahoma State. How important was it to have that sort of freedom to move to a place that was more comfortable for you?
It was very important. I love the transfer portal and what it can do for athletes. If they find themselves in an unhealthy relationship with their current school and they need to leave. But now there has been transfer windows that have been instated that have kind of restricted movement, like freedom of movement. So now student athletes really have to condense their timing process of when to make a decision on getting in the portal. It's more of a rushed process rather than the freedom of movement, which I know my organization with NCAA SAC, we've really been vocal about our opinion against transfer windows and how it really minimizes the freedom that certain athletes get, but it really opened up for football in general. So previously, you could transfer whenever between like July 1st or June 1st. There were certain dates, and so now it's like shrunk, and I think it changes the transfer portal for sure, just because students now have a different way of thinking, whereas before they could transfer whenever. And so I think that the transfer portal is great. I found myself a home. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at it like that, like if you're leaving a not very good situation and then you find your forever home at another place, mm-hmm. It's amazing. But I also think it can be taken advantage of.
Last question, we'll get you out of here on this. You are the czar of college athletics. What is one thing you would change about anything having to do with college sports?
Honestly, I think it would have to do with the transfer portal. I think that we need to figure out a way to instill some protections against those student athletes who go in and never find a home again. Mm-hmm. The transfer portal is large, and
I think it was up to 1,300 the last we checked.
Yeah. Right, and it's you can drown in it. Mm-hmm. If you don't market yourself or send those emails, get your name out to recruiters at different schools, whatever sport it is, you can get lost in the portal. And I feel like if I was if I was on D1 council or something like that, I could help change or create some legislation for protections against those student athletes. Like if they go in and they get lost and they don't find a home, what is their backup plan? What could we do from their current institution to help them get back on their feet? Like, I don't know what that would look like, but I think some conversations should be started for that.
Well, I hope the next NCAA president hears that and kind of can take some advice from that. So, Morgyn Wynne, thank you very much for joining us today. For SBJ Spotlight, I'm Austin Karp.